on the stage. Welcome. Wow. What a year this has been, as challenging as this year has been, as much as we've been tested to the limit, and there's more to come, still it makes me that much more grateful to be able to put all that aside for a little while and enjoy the better part of this time of year, right? Yes, yes. So we want all of your symphony board members want you all to know that in addition to this concert, we're keeping on planning concerts, raising money, working in your children's schools, okay? This doesn't end tonight. We have to adapt, and we will. I think you've seen that we will adapt as needed, right? We're here, we're not going anywhere. As you enjoy today's performance, it's my hope that each of you and all of your families have a joyful, peaceful holiday season. Enjoy.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I guess I'll pull down my mask to talk. Welcome to all of you out in the parking lot watching, and all of you here, our socially distant crowd, our socially distant orchestra. So again, we're in a totally new world here. So this concert, as you, if you are a season ticket holder, or if you saw our season brochure, was originally called Brassy Holidays. Well, the governor put an end to Brassy Holidays because we aren't, any windblown instrument that is brass or woodwinds are not allowed to be played in a facility. So we are have now a string and percussion group. So that is the group that you see on stage. You'll hear the strings, you heard the strings and the percussion, and you also have a treat to hear just the percussion section by themselves in a little while. This is also a different concert because, you know, you're encouraged at this, especially in the parking lot, but even here, if you want to pull out your phone and, you know, tweet about your experience or Instagram the pictures, it's our Instagram is Rapide Symphony, one word, same thing with our Twitter, so feel free to get out and, you know, spread the word about that we are doing concerts here in Alexandria, so feel free to do that. The first piece of music was called Boughs of Holly, and it was an arrangement performed by the Trans-Siberian Orchestra. Have anybody seen those Trans-Siberian Orchestra? We did it without the, you know, smoke machines and without the lights and stuff. But the next two are actually quite lovely arrangements of, more traditional arrangements of Christmas carols. The first, a French carol called Bring a Torch, Jeanette Isabella, and the second, Greensleeves, of course, also known as What Child Is This? Thank you. And now for something completely different. A steel drum version of, what song is it again? Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas.
Thank you.
that was a version of O Come, O Come, Emmanuel that was recorded by Mannheim Steamroller. So if you're a fan of Mannheim Steamroller, maybe you've heard that version before. Our last piece of music before our intermission, by the way, it's going to be kind of a short 10-minute intermission so the people in their cars and all of you can stand up and stretch out a little bit, but just 10 minutes. And so our last piece of music before our intermission is a pop song by Mariah Carey that's become actually kind of a standard Christmas song fairly quickly, called All I Want for Christmas Is You. want to acknowledge the four percussionists that we have. They did great, you know, the first half is great. And they're not just drummers, huh? They're real percussionists, as you heard on the first half. Greg Lyons, Mel Mobley, Oliver Molina, and Brian Nosny. And our next piece of music is for orchestra with a narrator or a storyteller. This is a piece called A Dickens Christmas, and it is the entire story of Christmas Carol with Ebenezer Scrooge and all the characters. So please welcome our narrator, Cody Walker.
Christmas time, a good time, a kind, forgiving, charitable time indeed. Indeed, Christmas time is not the time when most of the populace expects to hear a ghost story. But I will endeavor in this ghostly little story to raise the ghost of an idea, which shall not put you out of humor with yourselves, with each other, with the season, or with me. I only wish that it might haunt you pleasantly. For Christmas time is a pleasant time, the only time I know of in the long calendar year when men and women seem by one consent to open their shut hearts freely and to think of all people as fellow passengers to the grave. And therefore, though Christmas has never put a scrap of gold or silver in my pocket, I believe that it has done and done me good and will do me good. And I say, God bless it. On a cold and foggy Christmas Eve, old, tight-fisted, and covetous Ebenezer Scrooge sat busy in the shivering chill of his counting house. In the dismal cell that was the next room, his clerk, Bob Cratchit, worked by a stove. The flame kept barely alive with less than one lump of coal to fuel the flickering ember. That afternoon, Scrooge reluctantly looked up at as a visitor entered his office. "A Merry Christmas, Uncle!" cried a cheerful voice. It was Scrooge's nephew, Fred, who had arrived full of spirit of Christmas. "Come, dine with us tomorrow, Uncle," said Fred. It was a generous invitation, to which Ebenezer Scrooge sternly replied, "Bah, humbug! I am sorry." "Well, I'm sorry to find you so resolute," replied Fred. "But I will keep my Christmas humor to the last. So, a Merry Christmas to you, Uncle." As Fred left, two portly gentlemen, pleasant to behold, arrived at the door with their hats in hand, seeking to collect a charitable donation for the poor.
"Am I not taxed enough to help the poor?" barked Scrooge.
As he ushered them to the door,
"Are there no prisons? Are there no union workhouses?"
snarled Scrooge.
"Yes, but many can't go there, and many would rather die, sir," stammered one of the gentlemen.
"If they would rather die, then they had better do it and decrease the surplus population,"
sneered Scrooge, as he summarily dismissed them without a penny, after closing up for the day and begrudgingly giving Bob Cratchit the next day off for Christmas, Scrooge retired to his gloomy home. As he slid his key into the lock of the front door, an apparition appeared in the door knocker. It was the ghostly face of his former partner, Jacob Marley, who had died 7 years before that very night. Startled, Scrooge entered into his dark, cold house, stepped cautiously up the stair, and locked himself in his room. He sat down in the chair before the fire and began to eat his gruel. Soon, he noticed the faint tinkling of an unusual bell that hung in the corner. One by one, every bell in the house began to ring out, and ring out loudly. Suddenly, Scrooge heard footsteps, heavily thumping up the stairs with them clanking noise as if a person was dragging a heavy chain. A ghostly figure floated through the locked door. It was Jacob Marley, bound in chains and dragging behind him a trail of cash boxes, keys, ledgers, deeds, padlocks, and more chains wrought in steel. Though he saw the death-cold phantom standing before him, Scrooge fought against his senses and growled, "You're a humbug, I tell you! Humbug!" At this, the spirit cried, "I have wandered the earth for 7 years as a punishment for neglecting the needs of my fellow men. I have come to warn you that you have yet a chance and hope of escaping this same fate. You will be haunted by three spirits, Scrooge. Expect the first tomorrow when the clock tolls one." Then the ghost of Marley floated out through an open window into the bleak, dark night. Scrooge slammed shut the window, went straight to bed without undressing, and exhausted, fell asleep upon the instant. Scrooge awoke. It was still dark and extremely cold. Perplexed and deeply bothered with a mix of dread and astonishment as he thought and thought of Marley's ghost, he asked himself, "Was it a dream or not?" As the clock struck one with a deep and melancholy toll, Scrooge all of a sudden recalled Marley's promise of the first ghostly visit. At that, the curtains of the bed were drawn apart by a strange, childlike figure, dressed in white, from whose head sprung a bright, clear jet of light. "I am the ghost of Christmas past."
"Long past?"
Scrooge asked the glittering figure.
"No, your past,"
it replied softly.
"What brought you here?"
asked Scrooge nervously.
"Your welfare," said the ghost. "Rise and walk with me," he said, and taking Scrooge's hand, the two gently floated through the window. Instantly, the ghost transported Scrooge to the countryside where he had been raised. The city had vanished, as had the dark and mist. "What you see are but the shadows of things that have been," said the ghost. Recognizing every gate, post, and tree, Scrooge was brought to his old school, empty but not quite deserted. Indeed, Scrooge wept when he saw poor figure self, as he used to be, a solitary child left behind. The ghost motioned toward the classroom door. It opened and a little girl darted in. It was Scrooge's little sister, Fan.
"Father has sent me in a coach to bring you home, dear brother," said the child. "Home, forever and ever."
Scrooge reminisced sadly that Fan had died as a woman some years ago and had one child, his nephew, Fred. In but that moment, the schoolhouse was left behind them,
and Scrooge and the ghost were now no busy thoroughfares of a city. At a certain warehouse door, the ghost asked Scrooge if he knew it.
Know it?
Said Scrooge. I was apprentice here. They watched as a jolly Christmas party ensued, with dancing, singing, and merriment all around. Ebenezer, now a grown young man, and his fellow apprentice, Dick Wilkins, were leading the way with them all. The jovial old merchant, Mr. Fezziwig. During this whole of this time, old Scrooge's heart and soul were in the scene, and with his former self, he remembered everything, and he enjoyed everything. Quickly now, my time grows short, said the ghost, and as the scene faded to the past, Scrooge immediately saw himself at a different time, when he was slightly older in the prime of his life. There was an eager, greedy relentlessness in his eyes. He was not alone, but sat beside a fair young woman named Belle, in whose eyes there were tears. You have changed, Ebenezer. A golden idol has replaced me, she said gently. And I release you with a full heart for the love of him you once were, she continued, handing back to him her golden engagement ring.
Spirit, why do you torture me? No more, no more, cried Scrooge.
But there was more. Taken to a more recent Christmas, Scrooge saw the same Belle, now an attractive middle-aged matron, surrounded by her delightsome and loving family. As he watched, Scrooge was flooded with a dreadful awareness that he was quite alone in the world. Tormented by these scenes from the past, Scrooge exclaimed, "Remove me from this place, spirit! Take me back, haunt me no longer!" The light of the ghost was extinguished. Immediately he was back in his own room and sank into a deep sleep. Suddenly, Scrooge awoke, as again, the bell was upon the stroke of one. Scrooge rose from his bed, trembling at the sight of light emanating from the next room. The old hearth was ablaze, the room transformed, holly, mistletoe, and ivy hung all about. Sitting on a throne of meats, red-hot chestnuts, fruits, plum puddings, cakes, and seething bowls of punch was a jolly giant, glorious to see, who bore in his hand a glowing torch shaped like a cornucopia. Oh, come in and know me better, man. I am the ghost of Christmas present, boomed the joyful spirit, who was dressed in a deep green robe, bordered in white fur.
Spirit, said Scrooge submissively, I went forth last night, learned a lesson. Tonight, if you have aught to teach me, let me profit by it.
Ah, touch my robe, laughed the ghost. The room melted away to reveal the simple home of Bob Cratchit and his humble Christmas Day dinner. In came Bob with Tiny Tim on his shoulder. Alas for Tiny Tim, he bore a little crutch and had his limbs supported by an iron brace. With his contented family gathered around the hearth, Bob proposed a toast.
A Merry Christmas to us all, my dears, said Bob.
And God bless us. God bless us, everyone, said Tiny Tim.
Scrooge quietly asked, with an interest he had never felt before,
Spirit, tell me if Tiny Tim will live.
Oh, I see a vacant seat in the poor chimney corner, replied the ghost. And a crutch without an owner, carefully preserved.
If these shadows remain unaltered by the future, the child will die. and the spirit stood alone in an open space. It had been a long night, and strangely, while Scrooge remained unchanged in his outward form, the ghost appeared old. Looking upon the aging ghost, Scrooge was startled to notice a pair of wretched, starving children who had appeared from beneath his great robe. Their names are Ignorance and Want, said the spirit, and they belong to man.
Have they no refuge or resource? Cried Scrooge.
The ghost mocked Scrooge with his own words. Are there no prisons? Are there no workhouses? The clock struck 12. Scrooge looked about him for the ghost and saw it not. At the last stroke of midnight, Scrooge beheld a solemn phantom, darkly draped and hooded, coming towards him like a mist along the ground. Bending to his knee, Scrooge asked,
Am I in the presence of the ghost of Christmas yet to come?
The spirit answered not, but pointed downward with his outstretched hand.
Ghost of the future,
he exclaimed.
I fear you more than any specter I've seen. But as I know your purpose is to do me good, and as I hope to live to be another man from what I was, I am prepared to bear your company and do it with a thankful heart.
The phantom moved away as it had come, and Scrooge followed in its shadow, which bore him up and carried him along. With that, the city seemed to spring up and encompass them of its own accord, and they stood before the stock exchange, where a cluster of men were carelessly discussing the death of a rich business acquaintance.
Oh, it's likely to be a very cheap funeral, for upon my life, I don't know of anybody who will be going to it,
said one fellow with a yawn.
Well, I don't mind going, if lunch is provided,
observed another with a laugh, a cold, aloof, and unforgiving laugh. They left the busy scene and went to a foul and narrow part of the town, to a dingy, filthy pawn shop. The rascally owner, Old Joe, and some shady characters bartered after a collection of personal belongings stolen from some dead man. Scrooge was shuddering from head to foot.
Spirit, I see, he trembled. The case of this unhappy man might be my own.
The ghost spread its dark robe before him like a wing, and withdrawing it revealed poor Bob Cratchit's home once again. This time it was very quiet. The Cratchit family was gathered tenderly by the fireplace, but Tiny Tim was missing, gone. His little crutch lying as a memorial upon the mantel. Scrooge was moved with compassion. Pondering the scenes of the night, he asked the ghost,
Tell me, Spirit, who was the dead man whose things were bartered and about whom the men laughed?
In but a misty moment, he found himself in an overgrown, weed-choked churchyard. The spirit stood among the graves and pointed down to a neglected tomb. Trembling, Scrooge crept toward it, and following the finger, read upon the gravestone his own name.
Ebenezer Scrooge.
Shaking and clutching at the spirit's robe, Scrooge cried out,
Spirit, hear me. I am not the man I once was. I will honor Christmas in my heart, and I will try to keep it all the year. I will live in the past, present, and the future. The spirits of all three shall strive within me. I will not shut out the lessons that they teach. Oh, tell me I may sponge away the writing on this stone.
Mysteriously, the form began to shrink. Wide-eyed, Scrooge watched it as it collapsed. It became even smaller, dwindled down, and transformed into a bedpost. Yes! And the bedpost was his own! Ah, oh, I will live in the past, present, and the future! Cried Scrooge as he repeated and scrambled out the bed. The spirits of all three shall strive within me. Oh, Jacob Marley, heaven and Christmas, time be praised! Scrooge's heart swelled. He opened his window and, laughing and crying in the same breath, began to shout, Merry Christmas! Oh, to one and all! He called down the street to a passing boy, promising a shilling and half a crown to deliver a huge Christmas turkey to the Cratchit house. Scrooge dressed himself in his best, then went out upon the street, greeting everyone he met with a good-humored and delighted smile. He happened upon the portly gentleman who had been collecting for a charity the day before. He offered his deepest apology for his previous behavior, and he pledged them a huge donation. Scrooge then found himself at Fred's door, and knocking, asked if he could come to dinner. It was a wonderful party. A party with wonderful games and wonderful happiness. But the next morning, Scrooge arrived early at his office to catch Bob Cratchit 18 and a half minutes late in his arrival. Feigning anger, Scrooge began to scold Bob and then suddenly laughed. Oh, a Merry Christmas, Bob! A merrier Christmas, my good fellow, than I have given you for many a year. I'll raise your salary, and I'll endeavor to assist your struggling family. Make up the fires, and buy another coal scuttle before you dot another I, Bob Cratchit. Better than his word. He did it all, an infinity more, and to Tiny Tim, who did not die. He was a second father. He became a good friend, a good master, as good as the old city knew, or any other good old city, town, borough, in the whole world. And it was always said of him that he knew how to keep Christmas well. May that be truly said of us. And all of us. And so, as Tiny Tim observed, God bless us. God bless us, everyone.
As you know, if you normally come to our holiday concert, this is the time for the sing-along. Well, we're technically not allowed to do a sing-along, but I'll tell you this, well, especially in your cars, if you could pull out your phone, you could pull up the lyrics to a couple of the next songs, and you can sing behind your mask. I mean, I won't tell anyone. Or you could sing certainly in your car. The first song is Winter Wonderland, and the second one will be Frosty the Snowman. So if you're really good, you don't need to pull up the lyrics on your phone. But if you could take a minute and pull up the lyrics if you don't remember them. Again, Winter Wonderland and then Frosty the Snowman. I'm not supposed to hear you sing, so if you do sing, sing very quietly.
Mm-hmm.
And before our final piece, I want to thank you all for coming and thank all of you who are driving. This is certainly the first time experience, and honestly, hopefully the last. Hopefully we'll get everybody in here very soon for our next performances. But again, thank you all for coming, and I hope you have a very merry holiday season.